Major support for Louisiana Eats on WWNO provided by Zatarain's, proud producers of authentic New Orleans-style cuisine. Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889.
From WWNO New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. It takes a lot of inspiration and hard work to successfully open a new restaurant. Chef Ryan Prewitt of Peche Seafood Grill traveled all the way to Uruguay, where walls of fire are used to cook entire meals out in the open. We visit the Peche kitchen to see how Ryan's reproduced this experience indoors in New Orleans' warehouse district. Brothers Jeff and Michael Gulotta of MoPho only had to travel as far as their own backyard to marry traditional Louisiana ingredients with the Vietnamese cooking they love. And talk about invention. Chef Brian Landry of Born Restaurant created an easy way to cold smoke food in any home kitchen, and he'll tell us how. Get ready to think like a chef and cook like a chef on this week's Louisiana Eats. In New Orleans Warehouse District, Chef Ryan Prewitt cooks Gulf seafood on open fire over hardwood coals. Ryan's a member of the Fatback Collective, as well as executive chef at Peche Seafood Grill. On a busy weekday morning, Ryan welcomed us into the Peche kitchen, where he described his experience studying South American live fire cooking. Take us back to how the concept of live fire cooking came into your life and how it changed it.
So it came in during a trip I took with a bunch of friends of mine to Uruguay. And really, it was just this whole collective of chefs and food people that all went down there halfway on vacation, but, you know, halfway as a way to sort of educate ourselves about the way that other people were cooking. Traveling down there with a bunch of sort of barbecue cooks led us to this, basically cooking with these guys kind of in a field and cooking with their sort of traditional methods, which involved using fire in a way that was just entirely new to me. They are literally building walls of fire, just huge stacks of wood that they just set on fire. I mean, the fire is so hot that they're putting metal pots, you know, handmade metal pots within a few feet of it, and the water is boiling. Like, you can't even get up close to it. And they're pulling the coals that fall through a grate they have the fire burning in, and then cooking over them in either low heat or a high heat situation, or burying pots in it. And it was just this sort of entire kitchen where the cooking method was based on this giant amount of fire. I mean, that's kind of their thing. I mean, this whole like idea of cooking out in the open, this is what they do and kind of how they do it. And they were all very sort of matter of fact about what they were doing. But just seeing how you're able to use so many different levels, from the slow cooking to high heat searing to using the full power of the fire and everything in between, was just completely new and different.
You had been long involved with Donald Link and Steven Strzajewski, of course, who are the famous chef owners of Donald Has Herb Saint. They have Koshan together, and you had been the chef at Herb Saint, and you've been working within this group for about 8 years. So you come home from Uruguay, and how do you all decide to take what you've learned and apply it in a new restaurant?
So we had been talking about opening a seafood restaurant for years, and, you know, we were kind of wrestling with what direction the restaurant was going to go. You know, where it all kind of came together is we sort of all fell in love with these cooking techniques. We wanted to open a seafood restaurant, and we just sort of merged the two. It was really a pretty easy merger. You know, the ideas of cooking seafood over fire, I mean, grilled fish tastes great. You know, shrimp on a grill tastes great. And all these things, you know, these are sort of proven concepts. Where it really came together for us is that we wanted it to all happen over an actual wood fire device, kind of move away from the gas grills and those sort of more controlled cooking elements and have something that has more life to it, that has more energy. And the way that it sort of blossomed and to give us this whole realm of things that we can do with the grill and the ways that we can steer seafood in sort of interesting ways, interesting but not unfamiliar ways, you know, has been really rewarding.
So the cooking system that you use here, you all designed yourself.
Mm-hmm. We did. We designed it over the course of a couple of months, lots of napkin drawings, and then we were lucky to have a very talented welder in Donald's cousin, Dwayne Link, who was able to sort of take our scribblings and various measurements and ideas and fabricate something that really is better than we ever could have imagined.
Well, now that we've heard the story, can we please go back to the kitchen and see this amazing fire in action?
Absolutely. Let's go check it out.
Ryan took us back into the Peche kitchen to show off their amazing creation. Monopolizing a large portion of his line was a smoking hot open grill. A stack of logs over 3 feet in height burned in a closed iron box to the left of the grill. As the logs turned into glowing coals, the cook scraped them across the fire bricks, providing some impressive direct heat. Cleverly, the grill was designed so that up to 7 metal racks could be positioned over the fiery coals to provide different levels of heat.
So the first thing you notice is that it's hot.
Wow, it's really hot.
But, you know, we have a separate air conditioning unit back here. You know, we thought that had sort of spent enough time putting it together. We're a couple of weeks in. The guy that's working the grill, I see him start to get a little woozy and light. Tell him to take a break. He drinks some water. A couple of minutes later, he literally just falls out on the floor back here. We bring him back to life and realize that we've got to take some other steps. So we have this floor fan that we use to blow air across the bottom. We installed this door to make sure that we deflect all the heat backwards. When you shut the door, it's a lot cooler.
I see.
There's no getting around the fact that there's a lot of wood burning in there, and it's hot. You know, the wood will go about halfway back. Beyond that, it's almost impossible to reach your hand back there and do anything. So anything beyond that, it's got residual heat. It's usually fine. But you see it's kind of sloped here.
Yeah.
So everything at the front, when we stack the wood underneath here, that's where it's really hot. That's where we can really sear things. And if we want to sort of sear something and then slow cook it, we can sear it and slide it to the back or slide it up here and then kind of finish them up here.
And then over on the far right-hand side, the furthest away from the fire next to the grill, there's a metal box.
Right.
That the door's closed. What goes on in the metal box?
So this is our most recent toy that Dwayne built us. But I had been talking to him about building us a smoker. And I wanted to build a completely, you know, enclosed smoker that could also double as a high-temperature oven. And so we'll take coals from here, put some logs in there, shovel the coals on top of it. We put pans of ice in there, and then we can cold smoke things. So cold smoke cured fish, whatever we're sort of doing when you don't want to cook anything and just apply smoke as a flavoring element. Additionally, we can pull the ice out. We can load it up with wood. We have what is really the most important tool in the entire kitchen.
That is hilarious. To me, it looks to me like that's a blow dryer. What is that?
That's exactly it. It's a dryer tube attached to a hair dryer.
With duct tape and aluminum foil.
Yeah. We use it to force oxygen into the fire. So if you're sort of in the middle of service, you know, there's no knob that you can crank the heat up on, and maybe the wood is a little wet and you're kind of in trouble, you know, you can sort of come in here, turn the hair dryer on, and then all of a sudden you can have this sort of raging fire.
Wow.
But we built this into the system here, so if we want to use it as an oven, we have a pipe that has holes coming off of it that we can turn this on, and it shoots oxygen into the fire and will stoke it up so that it gets hotter.
Aside from your electric billows hair dryer, mm-hmm. are there any other special tools that you're using in this kitchen that you wouldn't find in an ordinary restaurant kitchen.
Yes. This sort of the other really important device is this sort of metal shepherd's crook.
Yeah.
And this is a Dwayne Link invention, but it's got a flat point on it and then a metal rod. And you use it to sort of reach under and scrape the coals around. And this is the tool that makes the fire work. You know, you take it, you can ram it into the wood. You know, it's solid metal. You know, it's very strong. Additionally, you can use it to sort of control where you put the fuel, how you sort of design the heat on the grill grates, whether you want to pull it forward, push it back, or clear it out to the side altogether. We don't use it just doing service. Like the flavor of the grill, the cooking apparatus itself, we've really tried to apply to everything. You know, we've put everything from oysters to every vegetable you can imagine, either in the grill, in the coals, on the grill, in the smoker. You know, it really leads to a lot of, you know, the sort of creative juices start flowing. And when all of our market produce comes in, whatever we're getting, you sort of look at it through new eyes. You know, you look at broccoli, you think of all the ways you can cook broccoli, and then you look at the grill and you think, we can grill that broccoli, or can we smoke this broccoli, or can we just grill, smoke, roast it to death and make a puree out of it, you know? And you sort of start looking at all of your produce and vegetables in a different way. And after spending so many years with stoves and saute pans and ovens, and you know, you run through all these methods and you're constantly reading and trying to educate yourself, and then you're sort of confronted with this contraption, and it just, the whole kitchen, it leads to this creativity that's brand new for everybody. I mean, none of the cooks here have ever worked on anything like this, and so we all sort of get to look at it as a brand new device.
That was Ryan Prewitt, chef at New Orleans Peche Seafood Grill. Not everyone has access to the kind of live fire at Peche, but cold smoking is another matter entirely. Chef Brian Landry of Bourne Restaurant is a master of fish cookery. Brian's here to tell us how you can cold smoke your favorite seafood in your home oven.
I think everyone's fairly familiar with hot smoking, where you're introducing smoke to a product you would, let's say, be grilling, and a high temperature is involved. What we're going to be talking about today is cold smoking, where we actually don't want the temperature of our product to be cooked with heat. In most cases, we'll be curing the product like the salmon or the smoked pompano and then introducing smoke to it without raising the temperature.
Do some foods adapt better to cold smoking versus hot smoking?
They do, and it also just depends on what the end product you are looking for. For example, smoked salmon is a cured product, but you can also hot smoke salmon. It just depends on what your desired outcome is.
Would you take us through this actual process?
Sure. In the case of the smoked pompano, what we do is we actually brine the fish before we're going to smoke it. So we would do a mixture of water, salt, sugar, peppercorns, bay leaf, fresh thyme, and we'll soak the pompano in that brine for about 8 hours. So it'd be just like if you were brining chicken or turkey or pork chop. We're actually brining the fish. Once it's been brined for 8 hours, we would then take it out of that brine, rinse it, pat it dry, and just leave it uncovered in refrigeration for another 8 hours. In the case of salmon, we would not use a brine. We would just make a salt and sugar mixture and pour that right on top of the salmon, and that'll help pull out some of the moisture. We then rinse that salt, pat it dry, and we'll actually let it sit up to 3 days uncovered in refrigeration until a sticky film called pellicle forms. Once that sticky film has formed on the salmon, that's when we know it's time to smoke.
I imagine many of our listeners, they don't have a smoker. They may not even have a spot to put a smoker. So can you tell us, how can you accomplish this trick without that conventional equipment?
Sure. What we always try to do is keep the temperature of the oven from rising. We want it to stay at room temperature. So we always put an ice barrier in between our heat source, which is where our smoke will come from, and the product that we're smoking.
You're starting off with a totally cold oven.
Correct.
Okay.
Not turned on, just hanging out at room temperature.
Okay. And then what happens?
So what we use to smoke in this case is something called smoke dust. And it actually looks like something you would find in the bottom of a hamster cage. It's wood chips that have been finely shaved. They come in all kinds of different wood varieties. We typically would use hickory or pecan, but you can buy cherry wood, apple wood, anything you can imagine. So once you have your smoke dust, you just put that in any kind of small container, a small metal bowl, small foil container. And then we would take charcoal, 2, 3, 4 briquettes, and we actually just put those right on top of our stove and turn the burner on. And once the charcoal is white hot, we would then add the charcoal to our container of smoke dust. We put that on the very bottom of the oven. On the first rack of the oven, we'll then put a container of ice. So any heat given off by those 3 or 4 charcoal briquettes is absorbed by the ice. On the second and third rack of the oven would be the product that we want to smoke, whether that be duck breast or pompano or salmon.
Or shrimp.
Soft shell crabs. That's another great one. So your smoke with your heat source, which is the charcoal, is on the very bottom of the oven. Then on the first rack would be ice. And then on all racks above that, second, third, fourth rack, would be whatever product you're going to smoke.
And how long does this take?
For something like salmon or pompano, we would typically just let it smoke for about 45 minutes to an hour. For something like a pork chop or a duck breast, we might let it go double that, an hour and a half to an hour and 45 minutes.
Something as tiny as a shrimp?
Same thing, same as the fish, about 45 minutes would be plenty.
Well, this was a culinary secret that I must admit is all news to me. So thanks for sharing this with us today, Brian. And thanks for coming to see us on Louisiana Eats.
Thanks for having me.
Chef Brian Landry of Born Restaurant. How do you make sure your fish is fresh and stays that way? Stay tuned, and we'll have all the answers about storing and cooking finfish when we come back. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain's. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. How do you make sure your fish is fresh and stays that way? The first secret is keep it cold, really cold. That's 32 to 38 degrees Fahrenheit. Fishermen, the minute you reel in the big one, cover it with ice in your ice chest. Whether you do your fishing at the grocery store or on the water, it's a good idea to ice filleted fish even when it's stored in the fridge. Every 5-degree reduction results in a marked loss of shelf life. For instance, fish held at 50 degrees will spoil 5 times faster than fish stored at 32 degrees. And when you're buying fish, trust your eyes and your nose. Fish eyes should be shiny and clear, and their gills a bright red. And there should be no fishy smell. Really fresh fish has a pleasant aroma with no hint of ammonia. I'm Poppy Tooker, and fresh fish from the Gulf are real Louisiana eats. Chef Christina Quackenbush's restaurant, Milkfish, is currently the only Louisiana restaurant featuring authentic Filipino cuisine.
Previously just a pop-up, Chef Christina has finally achieved her goal of opening a permanent location for her restaurant in New Orleans' mid-city. Recently, I tasted her Filipina-style ceviche and was simply wowed. If you're a fan of ceviche, you've probably experienced the south of the border style, where lime juice is the acid used to cook the fresh fish. The Filipino version is very different and actually creamy. I sweet-talked Chef Christina into sharing her recipe with our Louisiana Eats listeners. In the Philippines, grouper is usually the fish of choice, but here Christina uses fresh Louisiana drum. The fish fillets are cut into half-inch cubes and then covered with coconut vinegar, an ingredient easily obtained in any Asian grocery. Then, 2 teaspoons of salt and a tablespoon each of fresh grated ginger and fresh chopped chilies are added for each pound of fish. The fish cooks itself by marinating in the refrigerator for at least 4 hours. To finish the preparation, all of the liquid is strained off of the fish, and she adds a can of unsweetened coconut milk, chopped green mango, purple onion, and bell pepper. You'll love this delicious, colorful dish that's perfect for the hot days to come. For a copy of Christina's Milkfish Filipino Ceviche, visit our Louisiana Eats website at wwno.org or louisianaeatsradio.com. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Chris J. is a food blogger for the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau. You can find his weekly blog every Tuesday on 20by49.com. He's also our Louisiana Eats roving reporter for the north part of our state. So, Chris, take us up to northern Louisiana and tell us what's going on.
I'd love to, Poppy. I wanted to tell you about a place called the Mabry House. It's a converted Victorian mansion in Shreveport's Highland neighborhood, which is a fun, funky little neighborhood, probably the most unique in the whole community. And they serve really old school, upscale, fine dining with no sense of irony whatsoever. I mean, this is very straight-faced, baked Alaska flambe for dessert, you know, a veal Oscar on the menu, crawfish cheesecake type, kind of very staid, kind of relic from a bygone era that's still kicking and thriving.
Well, you know, I'm really glad to hear there's someplace like that in Shreveport because, after all, down in New Orleans, we have places like Galatoire's and Antoine's and Toujac's, and there's a sense of tradition like that even in North Louisiana.
Absolutely, and that's what I thought was so fascinating about it. If you're looking for a Galatoire's-level experience in Shreveport, Mabry House is the place to go. I mean, it's definitely the only restaurant in North Louisiana with, like, a Griardine. You know, I mean, these people are, there's a very strict hierarchy in the kitchen and in the service staff. I've been there probably 3 or 4 times. It's a special occasion place for my wife and I. And I've never seen the server smile. They never crack a smile. But you turn around and they're there. You know what I mean?
It's the service is impeccable.
Absolutely.
And the food is very, very consistent. I mean, for over 30 years. Huh?
Absolutely. It's only candlelight. I mean, there's no electric light in the place. It's insane.
So who's the chef? Has it stayed the same the entire time?
Yes. His name's Steve Mylar. He and his wife Ginger run the place. What I love about it is it lets me kind of take a vacation in a reality of our community, Shreveport-Bossier, that may have disappeared for a lot of people. I mean, it opened up in the heyday of the oil and gas boom, you know, when I'm sure it did great guns business. But things have changed a lot. But they've hung on to their clientele, and in a way, they've sort of preserved that whole era of affluence and boom. You know what I mean? When Sarah and I go, we love to kind of walk past the Bugattis in the parking lot and just kind of, you know, think, hopefully they won't find out who we are and bust us back down to our normal place in society.
I imagine that it's jackets only.
It is. It's a very formal atmosphere, but something about that's fun. I mean, I come from a generation of food lovers that I think we were taught to sort of ridicule that sort of dining. The places that we're eating are more contemporary, and we kind of think those old school places are funny, but you really need to experience it. You need to go do it. Have the baked Alaska flambé for Pete's sakes before you just, you know, laugh at it in old cookbooks.
Okay, I'm bringing my party dress the next time I come north.
Wonderful. We'll get you a spot at the chef's table.
Chris J., our Louisiana Eats Northwestern roving reporter. Michael and Jeff Gulotta spent more than 30 combined years working in fine dining restaurants before they decided to open up their own casual eatery in mid-city. Michael's MoPho chef, and Jeff handles front-of-the-house business. Although the atmosphere at MoPho is very laid back, there are fine dining touches the two can't seem to leave behind.
For me, it was, as long as I can remember, I loved cooking shows, and I liked to cook, and my mom was actually very supportive of it, and she used to tape them for me while I was in school. And so, and actually my favorite was Yan Can Cook. And she would tape it for me, and I'd come home and watch it. And then on weekends, I was allowed to cook for everyone. And I used to do it almost every weekend. So she would buy all the food and help me do the cutting and the chopping, and I would cook.
Jeff, what about you?
I just made the accident, I think, of getting my first job in the restaurant industry. And ever since then, I had enough experience to get another job in the restaurant industry. And slowly but surely, I worked my way through college waiting tables and then on to some wine training, became an entry-level sommelier and then a maitre d', and then before I knew it, you know, looked up and the field I had chosen in college didn't exactly provide a guaranteed job, but my restaurant skills did, so here I am. Yeah, that degree in fine arts has fully qualified me to run a steakhouse for a living, a couple of other things, and now a Vietnamese restaurant.
Well, the fine dining restaurant, of course, where I first met the two of you all working together was Restaurant August, John Besh's beautiful restaurant. So tell me about what precipitated you leaving that top shelf establishment and breaking out on your own in this way.
Well, you know, I think what was fun about it was we wanted to do something a little more casual, and we wanted to do something in the neighborhood, and we wanted to do an industry restaurant, a restaurant for industry people, because, you know, we all kind of live in the same neighborhoods, we all travel in the same circles, we all go out together on our days off and eat, and traditionally we eat Vietnamese food or Thai food because the flavors are really light and fresh and vibrant. And it's kind of a break for us because we're tasting heavier foods all day. And not that those foods aren't fantastic. They're fantastic. But that food, for some reason, is just what we gravitate to on our days off. And so it just worked out perfectly.
Yeah, same here. I think it was a kind of a mixture of what we enjoyed eating during our time off in addition to the fact that I think there was kind of a need for it at the time, especially in this neighborhood. Mid-City, I think, is on the move. I think it's definitely a neighborhood that you're about to see really explode. And we just decided that, hey, I mean, you know, I live 3 blocks from here. I think he lives 5 blocks from here. It's nice not having to head down to the CBD every day and find a place to park and all that kind of stuff. I think it was another part of it. It was a lot easier to do it here close to home.
And I think that brings up another point is that, you know, we wanted to be kind of away from that downtown action because we wanted to be a spot where people could sit and relax on their day off and enjoy our deck or enjoy the garage doors that open up and when the weather's nice and a place where you don't feel rushed and you're not going to break the bank to come here, but we're still going to source everything locally. We're still going to get all of our vegetables from Cubby Rise or Pelican Produce and our, you know, beef from True on Farms and our pigs from Chapapila and all the great names that you know. We're still bringing it in the door here. Because we were able to come to a smaller neighborhood, we're allowed to charge more reasonable prices, which we wanted to do for families around here and the industry folks around here.
Well, I have to say, one of the things you've definitely accomplished is the dining experience is a complete 180-degree turn from Restaurant August. Tell me about, like, the choices to make some of these dramatic changes.
Yeah, I think that the setup of the tables and just the style of service and the all the way down to the cocktail and wine list and everything like that, I think it's inspired by what we've always done as fine dining restaurateurs, but not necessarily defined by it, if you will. We wanted to take kind of pick and choose, you know, pick what we wanted to bring to the table and put on the table, as the case may be, but also don't feel the need to be so, what's the word I'm looking for here? I guess
fancy.
Yeah, I guess that's it. Yeah, fancy. Yeah, that's pretty much the crux of it. You don't need to be fancy. You need to, we're more worried about the ingredients and the experience and just having a good time. Sometimes I think that might get lost when you're kind of swept up in the pomp and circumstance of fine dining, all the little things at various conventions. And don't get me wrong, I mean, I'm a certified sommelier. I mean, this is those are the things that sort of defined my career for a really long time. And it was strange to swim to this other end of the pool and realize, okay, maybe we can still do this without all the steps and the sequences and the various protocols. It's been difficult not freaking out over some of these smaller things that would be anathema in fine dining. Sometimes it's almost a little refreshing to be able to look at a server and go, well, that's really not that bad. I mean, in my old job, I probably would have lost it right now had I seen that. But now it's actually a little bit fun, and the guests all laugh and smile. And as long as everybody's having a good time, I don't see any reason why we need to crack down on it the way that we once did.
What kind of mental bridges have you had to cross, Michael?
Good question. Okay, so the mental bridges we had to cross, I think, were being able to focus more on making sure what the guests got, really the flavors came through. Because, you know, we are a faster-paced restaurant as far as how many plates are sort of flying out the door. And so we can't spend as much time on the perfect plating and the things like that. So we had to make dishes that were beautiful when you got them, but more beauty out of how little you did to the food as opposed to how much you did to the food, if that makes any sense.
Absolutely.
Letting the flavors speak for themselves and not overthinking it and knowing what to leave out of a dish or knowing what to leave off of a plate to where the guest just got something that was so tasty that, you know, they had to come back. That's kind of the idea. And then also just sort of bridging that gap between growing up in New Orleans and growing up with this kind of cuisine with all the great seafood and all the long growing seasons and great produce and sort of using that to apply to the Southeast Asian way of doing things and flavor profiles and bringing those two together in a way that seems effortless but also makes sense. We don't want to overthink it, really. That's the one thing you can go wrong with in food is overthinking things, and we just kind of want to do it from a point of what would we want to eat.
So what has the reaction been from your former coworkers and employers from those white tablecloth restaurants? What do they have to say?
I think in that respect, I'd like to think that we achieved our goal and that they've really enjoyed it, and to the point that they've come back again and again. You know, we roast a whole pig every Saturday on our pit out on the deck. And being out there, and it was a beautiful night, and the doors were open, and the restaurant was full, and it was like, man, I would want to sit down here.
Yeah, I think we get the same feedback from front-of-the-house people. In fact, if anything, all the guys that I used to work next to having to wear a suit are pretty jealous that I'm wearing a mechanic shirt and a pair of jeans to work every day after spending pretty much my entire career having to pick up dry cleaning every other day. So I think that's one of the reasons that a lot of them are like, man, we need to open a casual restaurant. It looks like you're having a hell of a time. And so it is. It's a lot more fun. And some of them, I mean, they'll have brought a few things to my attention that needed to be brought to my attention, which is also a great thing, and I would do the same thing for them. We always do that kind of stuff for each other. You're always kind of looking out for each other.
That was Michael and Jeff Gulotta of MoPho, a New Orleans Vietnamese fusion restaurant in Mid-City. We'll be back after the break with more from the Gulotta brothers. Stay with us. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Markets. Welcome back to Louisiana Eats. We've been speaking with brothers Michael and Jeff Gulotta of MoPho, a restaurant with a new take on Vietnamese cooking in New Orleans. After spending years in fine dining restaurants, the brothers started their own place, which caters to the palates and pocketbooks of their industry companions. As a brother team, do you all have any differences, or have you, regarding how things go in the restaurant? And if so, how do you settle that?
Is that what Jeff, your partner's for? Does he make the final decision, or how does that work?
I think we got most of our problems out of the way in our teens. Yeah, we beat those out of each other. But the good part about it is that we can sort of, when the chips are down, we can kind of lay into each other. But at the end of the day, we're just brothers, so it doesn't really matter. And now that Jeff's here, yeah, that the other Jeff. So two Jeffs and a Mike. And now that he's with us too, it's almost a newer dynamic. I think that's almost the new thing that we have to learn, because we have to pass it by all three of us, and we have to make unanimous decisions. Thankfully, we all speak the same restaurant language, all three of us, so that helps out a lot. But nowadays, there's definitely a lot more of a stop and talk things out and make sure we come to a consensus.
We still do call a lot of audibles, though. I think we definitely have a two-minute offense still. But I think that from time to time, we'll kind of lay into each other at the end of the shift a little bit. At the end of the day, I mean, it's been the easiest partnership that I've ever had as far as a chef slash general manager dynamic was working with my brother. As he was saying, we not only speak the same language, but like, you know, Jeff Bybee and I have the common background of both coming up through the ranks at the Emeralds Group, so we speak that language together. Mike worked there briefly, but then he spent a lot of his time coming through the ranks at the Besh Group, so all three of us, you know, speak the Besh language, and we have these points of reference that we can kind of bounce off of each other. Again, it's calling an audible, but it's a play we all already know from one of the places where we worked. We're tweaking it a little bit, making it our own, you know, just having fun with it. And I think that's another thing that we've been able to do here, is have a lot more fun with it and keep it a lot more engaging from our standpoint as owners and operators.
Well, I think that the fun of the restaurant name has been carried right out onto the plates. And I'd like to talk a little bit more in depth about the concept, because there's a lot of fusion food around. There's a lot of people claiming to fuse one country to another country. And Michael, I feel like you took some traditional things and tweaked them. Did you think that traditional New Orleans food was becoming stale and needed to evolve?
I don't think that. I think there's always a place for those altars of great New Orleans cuisine. But I also think that a lot of the great restaurants were born out of that. You know, all the great New Orleans Italian restaurants, they're not Italian. They're New Orleans Italian. Even, you know, the Brennan's family, you know, even though they tried to make a great French restaurant, they're Irish. And it's just the way it is. And it's the way that New Orleans assimilates its cultures. And the most recent influxes have been, you know, the Vietnamese and the Hondurans, and they haven't yet assimilated. And in a lot of respects, they're not. They're sort of moving out and forming their own communities. And maybe it'll only take a few more generations for them to do that. But I also think that we can take that cuisine and make it more New Orleans, or find a New Orleans approach to it. The one example I like to use is whenever I go eat fermented black bean braised seafood at any of the Vietnamese restaurants, it always reminds me of gumbo. And so when we brought the dish here, I said, well, let's roast those crabs in the pan, and let's make a really dark roux, and then let's start it like we would start a great seafood gumbo, but then let's add in that fermented black bean paste, and let's add in those fresh fermented black beans, and then we can make this really complex sauce that is both a New Orleans dish for any New Orleans who eats it, but also Vietnamese for any Vietnamese person who eats it, and sort of bridge that gap. And so it's finding those similarities between the two cultures and the two cuisines, thinking how, in a few decades, how would that culture assimilate, as opposed to just sort of fusing and ramming things together? You know, how would New Orleans assimilate it like it has done to so many other great cultures that have immigrated here?
I think if there's been any sort of kind of backlash that we have had in the beginning, it was people assuming that we were going to be traditional. And they come in here and they kind of would freak out a little bit that, like, this isn't like I get it on the West Bank. This isn't like I get it in New Orleans East. And it's like, no, it wasn't meant to be. It wasn't even remotely meant to be.
We want you to know that you're in New Orleans when you're eating in this dining room. We don't want it to be that you could be in any Vietnamese restaurant anywhere in the country. We want you to know that you're in a New Orleans restaurant first, and then a Vietnamese-inspired restaurant second.
Well,
definitely.
It's working, and so I have to ask, what's next for the amazing Gulotta brothers?
Oh.
A day off?
Yeah. That would be great. A day off would be wonderful. One of the dreams I think we always had was making the style of cooking and the style of service and everything like that that we had worked in more approachable and affordable to, I mean, I remember back when I was a waiter, I couldn't afford to eat, I still can't afford to eat at half the restaurants that I worked at. For all the time I worked in fine dining, most of the restaurants that I've worked at, I probably went and sat down once, maybe twice. Did I eat a lot of food at Restaurant August? Absolutely. But it was standing in the back in the kitchen next to him, tasting stuff. Or, you know, what do you think of this dish? You know, that sort of thing. I very rarely had the opportunity to come in and sit down and do the sort of, you know, grand tasting and wine pairings and things like that that I was part of designing and a part of helping with. But I think what we want to do here is maybe give those, again, those waiters and waitresses and cooks and stuff like that a chance to come in here and afford to eat a tasting menu, to taste some wine, and to maybe get a little bit of the craft that we're trying to perfect.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to come out the kitchen and off the floor and sit down in the dining room here at MoPho with us.
Pleasure was all ours. Thank you.
It was a great experience. Thank you.
MoPho's Michael and Jeff Gulotta.
Oh, get a listen to some. Oh, a little dab will do ya.
The Gulotta brothers are not the only pair of Louisiana siblings who share a fanatical appreciation of Vietnamese cuisine. Food writer Scott Gold sent us this ode to his favorite Southeast Asian dish.
My brother Eric loves pho. Actually, it's not really love. Love is more natural and harmonic. This could more appropriately be described as an obsession, a psychological tic that tells him if he doesn't get some of that hot Vietnamese noodle soup in him on a regular basis, his internal organs will shut down and cerebrospinal fluid will begin leaking from his ears, followed by a dramatic and painful death. It's serious. Over the past couple of years, Eric has been on a one-man personal campaign to sample the pho at every Vietnamese restaurant in the greater New Orleans area. His go-to is always pho thai, which incorporates rare steak, usually from the beef flank, though every now and again he'll switch things up and go with pho nam, brisket. As the steaming bowl is set in front of him, the ritual begins. Add a squeeze of lime, bean sprouts, sliced jalapenos and basil leaves, then squirt in enough sriracha sauce to turn the broth a vibrant orange. Then commences the eating, which Eric does with practiced, studied movements. Each slurp of broth, bite of beef, and mouthful of noodles accomplished with contemplative, almost robotic precision. By the end of the bowl, which he tilts to his face to ensure not a drop of soup escapes him, my brother is finally satisfied, even though his face is crimson and pouring sweat as though he's been pacified by the kind of mace they use on grizzly bears. He is a red, sweaty mess, grinning ear to ear like a maniac. When it comes to Asian noodle soups, my first and true love has always been Japanese ramen. Not that pho isn't perfectly lovely, but the heart wants what the heart wants. And, of course, my heart is in my belly. Recently, however, my opinion of pho has begun to change. It might be Eric's subtle influence, but more likely, it's the fact that I have discovered pho ga, a rich chicken broth with rice noodles, chicken, and onions. Essentially, pho ga is Vietnamese chicken noodle soup, something special to me and to pretty much anyone who's ever been home from school sick as a child, preferably watching The Price is Right. Chicken noodle is the penicillin of soups, restorative, comforting, and essential. It is a magical bowl of soup, perfect for just about any occasion. Cold out? Pho ga will warm you. Hot out? Spicing up your pho ga will make you sweat and thus cool you down. Bad day at work? Pho ga, of course. Excellent day at work? Celebrate with pho ga. Hungover? Better get some pho ga in you stat. Lord, I'm starting to sound like my brother.
Scott Gold is a food writer in New Orleans. His Food Porn Fridays column is available each week through nolavie.com. New Orleans native documentarian and writer Suzanne Pfefferly's first film was Vietnamese cuisine in New Orleans. Suzanne sat down with us to explain how her personal journey through Southeast Asia inspired the documentary.
I like traveling places where the culture is very different than my own, I guess. I had been to India and Egypt before that. Vietnam, I was fascinated with partially because of the history. I studied the Vietnam War in school and things like that. And it also just struck me as just such a beautiful country, geography-wise. And the culture was so fascinating to me. I wanted to learn more about it. When I went over there, it was just, it was everything. It was more than I imagined. It was incredible. It was beautiful. The people were so nice. And the food was amazing. And there's so much to it. There's the bustling city of Saigon, and there's the villages and the countryside and a more laid-back Vietnam than I knew. Going over there, I was a little bit apprehensive about what their reaction would be to me as an American, and I wasn't sure what to expect. I didn't know anyone who had been to Vietnam or, you know, could give me that sort of information. But what I found is that they were very warm, welcoming. They wanted to hear a little bit about me and my story and what life was like in America. I wanted to hear about them. And there was a nice cultural exchange between me and the other person. And I never experienced that animosity or bitterness that I thought that I may encounter.
What were the differences that you saw in the food in Louisiana versus the food in Vietnam?
I think one of the most glaring differences to me, especially when I went over there, is that they don't use spices necessarily to add flavor to their dishes. They use a lot of fresh herbs and things like that. And a bowl of pho was the first dish that I had over there. I arrived late at night and I had pho for breakfast. So
now, explain for those who might not know, what is pho?
Pho is essentially like a noodle soup. You can add chicken, beef, different types of meat, pork. But it's this flavorful broth with vermicelli noodles, and you add different herbs like basil, mint, you know, things like that, sriracha sauce, however you want to flavor it or spice it. But it's very healthy, not a whole lot of oil in there, and it's just zesty, I guess would be a good way to describe it. At mealtimes, you'll have the whole family sitting around the table sharing dishes, talking about the day, praying before meals. There's similarities. I think the contrasts lie in the type of food and the way it's served. There's different dishes and that sort of thing. But
they're big on lots of courses, too.
Yes. There will be rice, of course, but they'll have like a pork dish, like caramelized pork, fish, salad, like bok choy salad that's steamed, and it'll have shrimp added to the bok choy. Different things like that. So there's several varieties of options on the table, and you'll have a soup. So you'll have like the soup and salad, then you'll move on to the main courses that are already there. And usually by the time you're finished, you're too full for dessert, but there's always fruit, fresh fruit available. And so there's so much food, but it's healthy.
Well, Suzanne, we've always, well, at least since the fall of Saigon, had Vietnamese eateries on the West Bank and out in the East. But why do you think that we are suddenly finding this big proliferation of Vietnamese cafes everywhere?
I've wondered about that as well, but I think the food's becoming more accessible. They have new restaurants in Uptown. They have, you know, Dosan's in Mid-City, which has been there for a while. But I think another factor is that it's so healthy. Most of the dishes, for the most part, I mean, there's certainly things on the menu that aren't as healthy as others, but a bowl of pho or spring rolls, that's it's fresh. There's very little oil. There's not a whole lot of emphasis on sauces and things like that. And so you can eat a big meal and still eat healthily, not feel like you overdid it.
Suzanne Feverly, documentarian and author of the new book, Vietnamese Cuisine in New Orleans.
There should be a book where I can look to find my love. Ooh, yeah.
That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at wwno.org and louisianaeatsradio.com. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Our friends at Zatarain's are celebrating their 125th birthday with the world's largest crawfish boil. On Saturday, May 10th, from noon till 6 p.m., you can help them eat their way into the history books. 25,000 pounds of Louisiana crawfish will be boiled in New Orleans Champion Square. Learn more about this record-setting event
at satscrawfishboil.com. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by Dickie Brennan and Company and Linda Green, the Yakima and Ladies Soul Food Catering. Our media sponsor is Louisiana Life Magazine, the magazine of a great state. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. I'm Poppy Tooker. We'll see you next time. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.